God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel. We need to understand the only Israel that God has ever recognized as being true Israel has been the Israel that would take him at his word. That's the only true Israel in the mind of God. God will indeed restore that Israel to the land promised to their fathers. When will that restoration to the nation of the land take place? It'll take place at Christ's second coming, all the way down to his earth, to the earth. His feet will touch down here, according to Matthew chapter 24, verse 29, verses 29 through 31. And that's when he will send his angels to gather the elect, believing Israel of that time, Israel that will be taking him at his word, into the land that had promised their fathers. Obviously, Christ's second coming to the earth has not taken place as of yet. It will occur, but it will not occur until the end of the time known as Jacob's trouble, the end of that seven-year period of tribulation that Israel will undergo. And that seven-year tribulation period will not even begin until after the church of this age, the church called the body of Christ, has been caught up into the air to the place of our citizenship, which is in heaven, according to our apostle, the Apostle Paul. During the age of grace, we need to understand that God's not dealing with one nation, any nation, above another nation. So no people are any more special to God than any other people on this planet during this age. God is dealing with all men and therefore all nations alike today, and in accordance with the revelation of the mystery revealed to and through that new apostle, the apostle of the Gentiles, the Apostle Paul. When did things change? And why did they change? Why did Israel not get her land? And where in the Bible can we find that change take place? You see, the great division in Scripture is not between Malachi and Matthew, the division the publishing houses call the Old from the New Testament. The great division in Scripture can be found in discovering where he set Israel and his plan for Israel aside for a time. His program concerning the earth, that land promised to that nation, he set them aside for a time. We need to discover where he set them aside. And then we can discover where the great change in Scripture takes place. God's program for the earth is one thing. God's program for the heavenly realm is quite another thing. And this is what rightly dividing the word of truth is all about. Understanding the differences in God's program concerning a nation and a land, and his program concerning a new creation will give you much greater insight, much greater understanding of the Word of God. Our citizenship, as Paul tells us, is not on this planet. It's not on earth, according to Paul. It's in heaven. We're not waiting for the king to come. We're waiting for the church to go. Of course, God's going to return and resume his plan for the earth, his plan for that land, his plan for that special people, that special nation. And he's going to bring that plan to completion after we're gone. He's going to gather Israel to her land, as we've seen. But Israel will have to undergo what Scripture calls the time of Jacob's trouble, otherwise known as that seven-year tribulation, first. And that will be when the proud will become meek. And that's what that passage is all about. This will be the time when Israel will learn the lesson her scriptural history was designed to teach her. Understanding the differences between God's program for the earth concerning Israel and his program for the heavenly realm, having to do with the church, the body of Christ, the church of this age, the church of the age of grace, and where that change takes place in your Bible is what rightly dividing the word is all about. Once again, you see, what most folks fail to realize is that Christ had two different ministries. Two distinct ministries. His ministry on earth was directed at the nation Israel, as Christ himself testified in Matthew chapter 15, verse 24, where he said, "I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel." If you take Christ at his word there, folks, you've got to see that when Christ was ministering upon the earth, his ministry was focused on Israel and the land that had been promised to their fathers. But Christ didn't quit preaching when his earthly ministry came to a close. Christ's ministry from heaven after his ascension was directed not at a nation, but at a new creation called the body of Christ. And this new creation called for a new apostle, the Apostle Paul. It was from heaven that the ascended Lord of glory revealed to Paul God's plan and purpose for the heavenly realm and an age of grace. So again, where does this great change of program take place in your Bible? How can we know where God set his program with that nation aside for a time where he would cease working through the nation Israel? That's what we want to discover as we continue our studies. We want to be able to prove what portion of Scripture was written directly about us. So let's follow the progression. John came to make Israel's Messiah known to her. He said so himself in John 1:31. I knew him not, John states here, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore, or that's why, am I come baptizing with water. God couldn't make it any plainer than that. He couldn't put it in any clearer manner than he's just put it. John's ministry focused upon Israel and her call for a change of mind. God wanted Israel to change their minds. The issue, you see, during John's ministry was still the land. As John preached, the kingdom of heaven is at hand to those folks. The kingdom of heaven being a reference to the kingdom over which Christ will rule and reign, and from that territory promised to the nation Israel. When Christ came on the scene, John was the forerunner. But when Christ came on the scene here, he came preaching the same message as John had preached before him. Israel was being called upon to repent or to change their minds. The focus was still Israel, folks, during Christ's earthly ministry, and the focus was still the land promised to the fathers of that nation. We might ask, what would Israel need to change their minds about in order to gain entrance to the land that had been promised to their fathers? Well, that's pretty obvious when we look back at Exodus chapter 19 and Deuteronomy chapter 6. You see, Israel had agreed with God to deal with them according to a law contract, never understanding that they were totally incapable of producing righteousness before God through their performance, not if their performance was to be gauged in accordance with the law contract. When presented with a contract demanding obedience for righteousness, righteous works, we could say, righteous doings, we could even call it the fruit of righteousness. When presented with a contract that would require obedience for righteousness, look what Israel states in Exodus chapter 19, verse 8, where we read about their error in judgment. Notice it with me, Exodus chapter 19, verse 8. This will give us more insight into what Israel would have to change their minds about. And all the people answered together and said, all, notice that word, all that the Lord hath spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. Not only did Israel claim they could do it, notice the compounding of that error in Deuteronomy 6:25. It shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before our Lord our God as he hath commanded us. God had already proven their failure over and over again in their wilderness wanderings. Yet Israel continued to place their confidence in themselves. The issue for Israel was righteousness. The issue for Israel was righteousness from the get-go of that nation. And more directly, we could say the source of their righteousness. Israel was continually looking in the wrong direction where their righteousness was concerned. You see, there was nothing meek about Israel, folks. They were stiff-necked. They were hard-hearted, according to the Word of God. They were stiff-necked and hard-hearted. They were always trusting in their own capacity to gain righteousness through their performance. So we know there came a time when that nation Israel was set aside. God set that program on the shelf, in a manner of speaking, as he called out Paul, the apostle of the Gentiles.